Welcome to your opportunity to be quietly attentive and listen to what seems to be completely preposterous, utterly absurd. My purpose here is to speak what seems to be utterly absurd to the world. And you get to evaluate, is what's being said here, is it utterly absurd? Or is the world totally absurd? Is this preposterous or is the world preposterous? Keep in mind that both truth and lies cannot be both preposterous, right? One is absurd and the other isn't, has to be. Mutual exclusives cannot both be equally absurd. So my purpose in this world was to come here, and still is, and speak what seems to be completely preposterous. The job of those, there are others in the world, their job is to be attentively listen to this quietly, without struggling. Okay, without struggling. We call this walking together in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Just be neutral. Just allow the shock to take place. Because you hear this and you say, wait a minute, this is preposterous. And I mean, just don't struggle. And then you will get little confirmations in your life that, hey, maybe it's not preposterous at all. Maybe it's the world that's preposterous. And indeed, it is the world that's preposterous, okay? And yet, when you hear the truth, it will seem absurd. At first blush, it will seem, that's absurd, that's crazy. So you have to get past this without arguing, without struggling with it. There are many in this world who aren't able to do that right now, unfortunately. But hopefully you're not one of those. That's right. There should be those who are able to do this, to get this done. Now, keep in mind that indifference is not what we're aiming at. We didn't say just be indifferent, which is what most are right now. They're indifferent to this. That's fail. Okay. Be very attentive. And just allow for the shock of, say, well, I'm listening to something that's absolutely preposterous. What am I doing? Wow, this is amazing. And you'll be shaking inside. You'll be shaking, drumming. So this is preposterous. But I'm listening to it. Okay, and just get past this. Wow, just embrace the wow. Say wow. And then it will begin to dawn upon you, the truth of what's being said and the absurdity of this world. What is this world? Spirit is trying to stage a fake suicide. A fake suicide. Okay? That's what it is, actually. It's trying to fake its own suicide. And this world is like a suicide in search of a dyer. It's like a dream of death in search of a dyer. The one who's dying. It can't find the one who's dying. Yeah, we're looking for, okay, we got all this death, but where's the dyer? There isn't any dyer. So we're staging a fake suicide. That's what this world is all about. That's what bodies, personalities, all this stuff is all about. Now, if you're able to listen to this and again, there's nobody in this world who is able to listen to this without feeling some shock of the wow. And if you're able to, if you're actually doing this, then you are in very, very good company and extraordinarily on the right track. There, as I said, there are many who are as yet very, very unwilling to, they're like cave dwellers, okay. And they're trying to build a consensus among cave dwellers. Yeah, they pull everybody in the cave. Hey, what are you seeing? Well, we're seeing darkness. What are you seeing? Oh, I'm seeing darkness too. How about you? Yeah, I see darkness. Oh, okay. Darkness it is. You know, that must be the truth, right? We have a consensus here. So this magical thinking is what it is. So it is not easy to hear the truth in this world. The truth will always seem preposterous to the ears of this world, to the ears of the flesh. Spirit is staging a dream. It's staging a fake suicide of spirit. Spirit's pretending that it is committed suicide, and yet it hasn't. So it's looking for something other than spirit to be the one that's committed suicide. Yet there isn't anything other than spirit. There's not a second spirit, you know, that can commit suicide. So why is spirit doing this? Okay, we've explained this before, but I'm just putting the ground rules here. Is quiet, attentive listening, not asking questions, not arguing, not discussing. This all is allowing you, what's that, when you do that, what you're saying is, oh, this is preposterous. I need to help pull him out of this. He's behaving preposterously. I don't like this. I got to sort of coax him away from that, meaning the speaker. I don't have any desire to be coaxed away from it at all. And so that needs to be ground rules right up front. To speak the truth in this world will seem absolutely preposterous. Okay, so I don't want to be coaxed away from sounding absolutely preposterous. Okay, so don't do me any favors trying to coax me away from it. So the job of the listener is to hear this, and when I speak, I also get the wow. So we're in the wow together. We're walking together in the wow. There are cave dwellers in this world, a lot. And even little inconvenient truths cause them to absolutely go bonkers. And like you've disturbed an ant colony or something, they're just frantically, you know, whoa, you know, there's some hideous truth has arisen. What is this light? Even a little tiny little glimpse of light. You're seeing this in the political spectrum right now, where some inconvenient truths are being raised, that and people are saying, no, this is a joke. This is all a joke. It's a joke. This is a joke. So the way that magical thinking protects itself, defends itself, is it claims that the truth is just a joke. Whoever speaks the truth is just a clown, a joker, ridiculous. It's just a joke. It's actually the opposite. It's the world that's the joke. Okay. It's the world it's a complete joke. All right. It's victimization in search of a victim. It's death in search of a dyer, one who dies. It's illness in search of someone to be sick. It's symptoms in search of someone to have the symptoms. And yet there isn't anyone to have the symptoms. Not at all. So either we realize that, like for instance, I can say, I've never been sick. I've never been attacked at all. I can't be attacked. I've never been attacked. I can't be attacked. I've never been sick. I can't be sick. I've never been tired. I can't be tired. I've never been unhappy. I cannot be unhappy. So I have never suffered one bit. I've never suffered at all. Okay, now, you can say this. You can say this as a practice. Our practice is in three aspects. Assertions, full stop in the wow, and flipping the script. We can say, I've never suffered in the slightest. I have never suffered in the slightest. And this is absolutely true. What we've done is we've had a dream of suffering, and we're trying to find the sufferer. See, we can't find the sufferer. Where's the sufferer? We have this great dream of suffering, but no sufferer. And this is the problem, right? So we say, what? I guess we've got to find the sufferer. We'll never find the sufferer. There isn't any. There's a dream of suffering, but no sufferer. There's a dream of symptoms of a suicide, but no one committing suicide, actually. There's a dream of death, but no dire. But to put it in maybe the simplest terms, there's a dream of suffering, but there's no sufferer to be found anywhere. It doesn't exist. So what we are, which is spirit, has never suffered. Never suffered at all. Never been born, never died. Never suffered death. Never suffered fear. Never suffered fatigue. Never suffered tiredness. Never suffered confusion. Never suffered at all. All of this is only a dream of these symptoms. But there's no one that is having these symptoms, actually. It's just symptoms. Unattached to any sufferer whatsoever, actually. So we're in the wow phase now. We look quiet. We go quiet. We're in the wow phase. So we have to go fast now, because this is the apocalypse, lifting of the veil upon truths, inconvenient truths. And there's a large contingent of minds in the world right now who have not made any attempt to look outside the cave. So they're still, you know, totally immersed in darkness and believe that darkness is true. And any sign of light at all, it just freaks them out completely. And so what they're doing is they're trying to say that light needs to be illegal, that truth needs to be illegal here, because it disturbs them, makes them agitated and disturbed. So we have to very quickly get accustomed to the light. Very quickly get accustomed to the light. As this world here is at this moment in the control of the cave dwellers. And they have their chief caveman, you know, and cavewoman, you know, telling them how to be good cave dwellers. And to freak out at the slightest hint of any light whatsoever. It's important to note, I've never been attacked. I have never been attacked. I've never been attacked. Attack? What are you talking about? I've never been attacked. Suffering? What are you talking about? I know what you're talking about. I've never suffered. Unhappiness? I've never had any unhappiness. Problems? I've never had any problems. See, we're spirit. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. The body actually is totally neutral. Everything the body is doing, it's like an automaton, a puppet, that we're causing it to act in certain ways that play out in an attitude that we have. And then we claim the body's having this attitude, as if the body is the dire, the body's the suffering. No, the body's not experiencing anything, actually. That's a fake. Again, sounds preposterous, right? When you hear the really preposterous, that's great. The truly, you say, wow, that sounds very preposterous. Something should go on. Say, wait a minute. Maybe this is what I need to listen to. Now, the origins of this, we go over and over. The origins of this preposterous, absurd situation that spirit is engaged with, a dream of death in search of a dyer, in search of one who dies, and a dream of suffering in search of a sufferer that there isn't any. It's all of this is designed with only one purpose, and that is to fool, to trick, to deceive guilt, to deceive what we believe we call guilt. And again, the kicker, the preposterousness of it all, is that there isn't any guilt. It doesn't exist. So it's like we're really trying to deceive nothing at all. Nothing. How do you deceive nothing? We can't. It doesn't seem to work, does it? So, why are we doing this? We, spirit, want it to be greater than God, and we wanted to do this. We needed to change the will of God, change reality, have it different than it is, so our will would be greater than God's will. Well, we can't do this, because we are God's will. Creation is the will of God and shared. It's not there's some separate will. There's God and there's some different will. God created a different will. No, it's all God's will. We cannot change reality, the nature of reality at all. So we experience this feeling like nothing happened. We didn't change it. It was failure to change it. Nothing happened. Now, what we did in our desire to be greater than God, we said, oh, okay, something did happen. In fact, reality has been completely changed and actually destroyed. But we feel guilty about this. So we substituted this notion of guilt for this feeling, this experience of nothing happened, like a total failure. I can't change the will of God at all. So the feeling of this is impossible. We imagined out of thin air something called guilt, which is that we did it, but the feeling of impossibility is actually this feeling of guilt over having done it. And then we said, but I feel terrible. I mean, I something doesn't feel right. I feel like powerless. You know, this guilt has caused me to feel powerless. So instead of saying it's impossible and then accepting that I can't diminish myself, we said, whoa, I have this terrible feeling of guilt, and this feeling of guilt has caused me to feel completely diminished, terribly diminished and hopeless and powerless. You see, this is how we twisted it. And then we said, well, I'm not happy with feeling so powerless like this. And this guilt is causing me to feel powerless, so I have to get rid of the guilt. So we then recognized, we decided, well, oh, okay, so I feel powerless. This guilt is causing me to feel powerless because I caused God to feel powerless. And this is the price that I'm paying for this. Okay. Because I changed God's will, now God is powerless. But I'm feeling guilty about it, so the guilt is making me feel powerless. Remember, we are powerless to change reality. But if we try to hang on to this idea of trying to change reality, we feel powerless. But we've tried to account for it in some way other than that it's impossible. That's why we're feeling this way. So we said, no, it's not impossible. I did it. But this guilt is making me feel powerless now. The guilt over having done it is what's causing me to feel powerless. So we instituted an imaginary cause. Okay. We just imagined out of thin air, made it up, this cause that is causing me to feel powerless. So Spirit said, wow, I feel hopeless, I feel helpless, I feel powerless, I feel like there's nothing there. Wow, this is terrible. I got to get rid of guilt. And you see, it seems as though guilt is trying to kill Spirit, right? It's trying to destroy Spirit. It's making Spirit feel completely powerless. So we said, wow, guilt is it's trying to annihilate me, basically. Just as we tried to annihilate God and found it's impossible, instead of accepting that, we said, no, I did annihilate God, but now there's this new cause. I didn't know where it came from. It just appeared that now there's this new cause that's trying to annihilate me. And I feel like I'm almost annihilated here. So what we did then is we decided we have to fake our own death, so that guilt will think that it's killed us, and that in seeing that it's killed us, then it will be satisfied and say, ah, okay, I'm satisfied, and I'm no longer then trying to destroy or annihilate anything. Okay, and then Spirit thinks that then Spirit will then be free of this guilt, this terrible guilt that's trying to destroy it. So this is the scheme that Spirit has dreamed up. So Spirit is dreaming up the scheme as faking its own suicide. Because what else could death be but Spirit committing suicide, right? So Spirit is pretending that it's committed suicide. It's pretending that it's committed suicide. And this is what we call the world, actually. Again, just attentive listening, wow, full stop on the wow, walking together in the wow here, because this all sounds preposterous, right? Now, Spirit feels that this is absolutely essential. Spirit feels either it convinces guilt that it has died, that guilt has succeeded in killing it, or else spirit is going to feel completely powerless and helpless and hopeless and feel annihilated. All right? So spirit is very, very adamant that it must convince guilt that spirit has died. But spirit has a problem. Spirit can't die. It actually cannot die at all. It's still, keep in mind, spirit is still the will of God. Nothing has happened to reality at all. So spirit cannot die, it has to fake its death. It has to fake that it committed suicide, a fake suicide. And again, this is what this world's all about. And so we have invented this body to pretend that that's the one, that's spirit. And now it dies, you see, it suffers. The body suffers, the body is sick, the body dies. But in fact, the body's just a dream figure. It doesn't do anything at all. This is the fakery. Spirit is saying, oh, I'm now a body. It's body that's real. I'm now living in this world. It's this world that's real. Oh, I'm now aging. I'm getting old. I'm now suffering. I'm now being attacked. But it's spirit is actually acting out all this through the body. The body's not doing anything. The body's not being attacked. Nothing's happening to the body, actually. Spirit is pretending, dreaming, that this is happening to a body. The body's just a dream. It's a spiritual dream. And spirit is trying to use this dream to convince guilt that spirit is being attacked and getting sick and then dying. A dream of spiritual suicide. Dream of suicide, actually, is what it is. Okay, so this is, for me, it's like, okay, yeah, I've gone over this before many times. I got it. Now, in terms of, let's bring Jesus into the picture. The truth is that nothing at all happened to Jesus. Okay, we say, well, Jesus was tortured, suffered. So it just reset itself there. Okay. No, nothing happened. Nothing has ever happened to spirit. Spirit has never been tortured. It's never been attacked. It's never suffered. It cannot. Spirit is still the will of God. So all the dream is nothing but pretend suicide. It's all pretense, 100%. And I had this dream last night where this cat walked through the door. I put on these shorts and they were inside out. The inside is now out. You know, it's like, wow, what? And I said, well, I can't change. I don't have time to change back. Everything has been, you know, inverted, so to speak. What we think is true has been inverted. And then this cat walked in the door, and I was like overjoyed to see this cat. I said, oh my gosh, you've come back. You've been gone so long. I thought you were dead. I thought you were destroyed. And then the cat was like there, and the cat was just in this just total bliss, absolute bliss. The cat is so just happy and blissful, and I think no creature can be as blissful as a cat. I think a cat is a symbol of bliss, spiritual bliss. I had a cat just recently that was like that. The cat was just, seemed to be in ecstasy, constant ecstasy. It was amazing. We all just would laugh and marvel at it. You know, he says, what are you doing? Why are you so happy? Why are you in ecstasy? And the cat would just look at us, you know, and just... See, I'm in just total ecstasy. I don't know what, there's nothing causing it. That's just the way I am. So, this cat that we, this marvelous, wonderful cat that we used to know, that we thought had died and suffered and been tortured and all this, wasn't that walked right into my room? Walked right into our house here and lay down and looked at us and said, ah, I'm back, I'm so happy, you know, to be here. And I was just overjoyed. I was petting the cat. Hello, kitty. How are you? I'm so happy to see you. And the cat's so happy to be here. It was just astonishing. Well, the cat, the coloring looked like a lion. But it was a house cat, you know, not threatening. Problem with using a lion in any sort of symbology is a lion is, of course, very dangerous and threatening. This cat was not dangerous or threatening at all. Now, they called Jesus the Lion of Judah. Okay, the Lion of Judah, absolutely. King of the Jews, the Lion of Judah. That's Jesus. So, this was Jesus come back, came back. But not threatening at all, just like a kitty cat. So you might say Jesus is the kitty cat of Judah, actually. Which sounds preposterous, but it's true. I'm saying this. You can hear it and say, well, that's preposterous. Now, the lion is roaring and big and dangerous, can attack, and voracious, you know. But the kitty cat is just all bliss and happiness and, hi, everybody. And you want to come up and say, you know, say, hi, kitty. Say, oh, of course you can. No, no problem. All bliss, not threatening in the slightest bit. So this is Jesus. This is our spirit. What does the spirit need to be threatening about? And this happened just right after I'd done this practice, saying, I've never suffered. How can I suffer? It started out by attack and in the belief that, like, I've been so attacked. And I said, no, I've never been attacked. I have never been attacked at all. How can I be attacked? That's preposterous. What is it that can attack spirit? This, what is it that can attack God? That's completely preposterous. I've never been attacked. So I began this practice of asserting, I've never been attacked. I've never suffered. I've never died. I've never been sick at all. Never been tired. I've never been fatigued. Now this to me sounds preposterous because my whole life I've been sick and fatigued and exhausted and frightened and feeling of being attacked. My entire life, this is all I've experienced. And yet here I'm saying I've never been attacked. I've never even suffered the slightest bit of fatigue. And I was believing. I said, this is true. This is the truth. This other has just been a dream of symptoms. But these symptoms cannot apply to me at all. These symptoms simply do not apply to me in the slightest bit. So I affirm this. None of these symptoms that I've been dreaming of has ever been applied to me in the slightest bit. Never touched me at all. So I asserted this. I asserted it. And then I had this dream. Then I fell back asleep. Then I had this dream of this kitty cat, house cat coming in the door. Just walks right in. Lies right down, makes itself at home. You know how cats are, they make themselves at home. Ah, this is my home now. This is my home now. I said, welcome home, welcome home. Wow. And then I began looking at the cat for signs of suffering and damage and injury. And, you know, I didn't see any. The cat seemed fine. I was so shocked. I was so shocked. I was even trying to imagine something there. I said, but cat, you've suffered so much. You've been attacked so much. But you're back and you seem fine. Why, what is this? It's a shocker, right? Now the only difference between me and anyone else is I've gotten over the shock of the preposterousness enough so this can happen now for me. That's it. So I accepted, at some level I accepted. I said, yeah, so the whole notion that all this stuff happened to you was preposterous, wasn't it? It's just a dream. It was just a dream. It was preposterous. Nothing can happen to spirit. Spirit can't suffer. Spirit can't be alienated. Spirit can't be lonely. I've never been lonely. I've never been alienated. I've never been depressed. See, this is the assertions we need to make. These are the assertions we need to make. And of course, to almost everyone in the world, this sounds absolutely preposterous, doesn't it? And yet I did make these assertions, and the result was this dream, which was a very shallow dream because I had just dozed off, imperceptibly dozed off. I experienced this just below the surface. Jesus is back. I've told the world that Jesus is back, okay, in this world. He has returned. And so far, no one has said a word about this. Maybe they're being silent, you know, say, I'm trying to get used to, you know, the shock of this. That's fine. But you might want to just say a wow, you know. I mean, I'd say be silent, attentive, listening. But I would say one word that could be said is just wow. You know, that identifies you as really one of the tribe, so to speak, one of the tribe of Judah, one of the tribe of the ones who are on the path of realizing, you know, the truth. So for sure, hearing this as well, Jesus is back. This is a fact, and it's also very true that the information I was given, that after starting June 22nd, really, all hell would break loose in this world, and it absolutely has, hasn't it? And it's building like a storm. And I have been monitoring a little bit, and I shouldn't do too much of it. It's going as I thought it would go, unfortunately. Is those who, the cave dwellers, are defending their fiefdom ferociously. Their darkness, they're defending their darkness ferociously. They're saying, no, everything's fine here, you know. No, this is what we like. We like the death and the suffering and the misery. We're just trying to find the sufferer. You know, as soon as we find the sufferer, everything will be fine. It's doubling down. They're sure that they're going to find a sufferer. And there are others who say, no, wait a minute here. You know, what if there is no sufferer? I mean, you don't want to double down on this dream. I mean, things are going to get, you know, horrible. You know, I don't like this dream. It's turning into a nightmare. This dream's a nightmare. So there are those, maybe the ratio's about, you know, 80% cave dwellers, 20% those who are saying no to that. At least at some level, there's obvious to me. There's some at some level. There's just people who still have their recognition. They say, "Yeah, I mean, so someone's speaking the truth. What's the big deal about that? I'm not shocked about it at all. I've seen this all along myself." So there's stuff that people have seen all along. They just haven't really spoke up about it. You're not supposed to say anything about it. But the cave dwellers have taken this to mean that they're consenting, that, you know, no, there's no, we're not consenting, we just have better things that we're not shoving in people's faces, you know, really, but, and we thought, well, I'll be, you know, ostracized if I speak up, so I don't really want to speak up, but, you know, we're recognizing that these actresses and actors here are very phony. There's a lot of extreme phoniness going on. Something isn't right here, to say the least. We feel like something's very preposterous here, you know, and it bubbles up every now and then. We say, well, that's preposterous. But the cave dwellers are saying, no, that, you know. So, you know, it's the cave dwellers are now acting very preposterously. And it's sad, but it is what it is. So, you know, we don't want to join the cave dwellers, that is for sure. You never know, you know, where the actors, how it's going to play out. The Holy Spirit has a sense of humor, as do we. Remember, we're still spirit. Nothing has happened to us. So sometimes we get the truth coming from the seemingly most preposterous places, and this is what's happening right now. It's just blowing everyone's mind in the at a superficial level. Here, we're at the ultimate deep level here. Okay, most are not able to get to that right now. I fully expect to be relating with Jesus very soon. Fully expect it. And then people say, well, that's preposterous, you know. How can you say such a thing? Well, I am saying it because it's true. Nothing happened to Jesus at all. Nothing's happened to us. We've never suffered at all. We've had a dream of symptoms of suffering, but there isn't any suffer whatsoever. We made up this I claiming there's a sufferer. Oh, yeah, the I. Yeah, the I is suffering. No, there isn't any I. There's just symptoms of suffering. trying to convince guilt that it's spirit that's suffering and that it's spirit that's dying, committing suicide. Trying to convince guilt that spirit committed suicide. And of course, this whole thing is easily seen through. All we have to do is just recognize and accept we can't change God. We can't change the will of God. And that's it. We cannot diminish ourselves. We cannot be diminished at all. Now, the prevailing cultural matrix is that we have succeeded in diminishing ourselves, and we're going to succeed even more as we think if we just keep dreaming this dream of self-diminishment, we will finally find the sufferer. You know, we'll identify and we'll realize, oh yeah, there is a sufferer. And then we will believe it so much that it won't convince guilt that oh yeah. But keep in mind, there isn't any guilt to convince. This is our trouble, isn't it? So as we keep doubling down on self-diminishment, the dream of self-diminishment, it's all for naught. It's all for naught. There isn't any guilt to convince. So we're trying to convince ourselves, but we know it's not true. We know it's all fake, of course. We can't convince spirit that this is true. It's impossible. But what we think is that there's guilt that can be convinced, and there isn't. We made it up. Now, these characters that are appearing on the stage right now. There was that Cyprus, Greek Cyprus, and the leader of Greece, political leader of Greece, and the finance minister, I can't remember his name, who actually resigned in order to get a deal done for Greece. And they were speaking inconvenient truths to the European Union. Very inconvenient truths about the New World Order, about the banksters, about all this stuff, right? And, you know, everybody's freaking out. You can't say that. You can't say that. You can't say that. You know, it was like lifting the veil. The veil started to lift there. Greece started the process of lifting the veil. And finally, they capitulated. But certainly, they did a lot of work in lifting the veil. And now these, you know, this finance minister, some guy riding on a motorcycle, and he's just some kind of off-the-wall sort of person. Like, who is this guy? You know, but he's saying this stuff to the ministers and to the banksters and everything. I mean, it's just out. You think it's that preposterous what he's saying? We're saying, well, yeah, but it's true. Largely true. Okay. You know, of course, when you're speaking truth, these actors is not perfect. You know, here you're hearing, I would say, perfect truth or close to perfect truth here. But on this political stage is rough and tumble. It's ragged. You know, it's ragged, but it's right. It's ragged, but it's right. It's like a country song, a classic country song. Maybe, you know, it's a little raggedy, but it's a great song. And he said, well, it rings true. You know, the sentiment rings through the song. There's no, so these actors or actresses are maybe a little ragged, you know, but they're speaking, they're bringing up the veil, they're lifting the veil. It's like, hey, look, I'm about to open the window. And all the cave dweller says, what? You can't do that. You can't do that. Close the window. Close the window. You know, you must resign. You must resign. You must resign. Close the window. So we're getting this now, in the United States is getting this now with this actor called Donald Trump. He's a heck of an actor. You know, heck of an actor. And he's opening the window. He's opening a window in the cave and saying, hey, you know, look at these inconvenient truths. And the cave dwellers are just milling around like an underground ant colony, saying, you know, something terrible is happening. Something terrible to our nest is happening. Something's invading our nest. You know, the light. What is this? Shut the door. Resign. You must stop this. You must stop this. They're trying to make a joke out of it. Oh, it's all just entertainment. Huffington Post said, we'll just put on the entertainment section. This isn't real. This is just a joke. This isn't really happening. It's just a joke. And this is going into, you know, ostrich sticking their head in the sand. I mean, that's just total panic. Total panic. Because they thought that all of their attempts to diminish themselves, to commit suicide, really, nobody would say a word. You know, they just carried off just, you know, like that. And somebody's now actually speaking up. They say, that can't happen. That's not in our script. Now this Donald Trump character is just a character that's being acted, an actor acting this character, is somewhat ragged, you know? And the thing is that people pounce on the raggedness of it and completely ignore the context of what's, you know, the light that's being shown. They say, that doesn't exist, that's a joke. Yeah, it's the raggedness, what terrible raggedness, you know. Look at that comb over, is it a comb over? It's not a comb over, I don't know, you know, this guy's crazy, he's a clown, you know, that kind of stuff. This is the reaction, they're panicking. Same thing in the European Union, they were panicked about what Greece was doing, standing up to them. They said, these guys are clowns. They're fools. They're idiots. They don't know what they're doing. You know, like that. They make a big joke out of it. It is a joke. But actually, the real joke is this world. And so we can laugh at that. This is a complete joke, the world. It's spirit pretending to commit suicide. And that's all that it is. In order to convince something, that which doesn't exist, that it has committed suicide. This is literally, you know, the unragged truth of the situation. So I'm not, I don't have the acting skills to do the real ragged stuff, you know, that some of these politicians are doing. Much more sophisticated here and clean and smooth. That's what I do. I mean, it's like these cave dwellers, they see a little bit of light and they think that a fire has broken out, an uncontrollable wildfire has broken out inside their cave. And they're just, you know, frantically running for the water hoses. Yeah. Everybody man the water hoses. They're pouring the water on the... But the fire doesn't seem to go out. And they're saying, this is crazy. This is a joke. I must be dreaming. Now, those who have some perspective recognize and say, these are some inconvenient truths. Stuff that we don't want to look at, you know. We just think we'll sweep it all under the rug. And as soon as we find the sufferer, it will all be fine. But again, there isn't any sufferer. And this is what the non-dual, you know, the enlightened teachers, this is what they've told us. Now, I'm playing my role here. See, I have a role to play. And is to speak, sound preposterous here. Do people think this is absolutely preposterous? What are you talking about? And for the most part, the problem is I get ignored. Whereas if you speak a little bit of inconvenient truth, like Trump, everybody's, you know, you just suck the air out of the room. Everybody's like, I can't, I got to react. Whereas here, most people just ignore it because, you know. I'm not sure how to deal with that. It's preposterous. So I just ignore it. It's totally preposterous. So I have to deal with being completely ignored. I've been completely ignored my entire life here. And of course, I'm speaking in general terms. There are some that have paid attention, which is great. A few, right? But for the sake of emphasis, we'll say I've been completely ignored for the sake of emphasis. And I'm sure that you understand without level of confusion here. But interestingly enough, I was willing to do this. I knew I'd be completely ignored. You know, I hope it wouldn't be this bad, but I knew I'd be ignored. But I wanted to be ignored because in the previous life, I was very famous, and I was kind of like the Trump character, so to speak. I was very controversial. I spoke truth. I spoke truth to society, inconvenient truth. But I was also super successful, and I was hounded by people, autograph seekers, and those who were seeking me out because I was a celebrity. I was very famous, and I was sick of it. I said, I don't want to be famous at all. I don't want it. I hate it. I want everybody to ignore me. This is my desire. I said, I just want to be ignored. I just want to be left alone. My God, you know, it's. So I had this opportunity where I could come into the world and I could work on saying what seems to be preposterous to the world, and people would ignore me. And so, you know, I think anyone else having gone through this, they couldn't handle it. They couldn't take it. I mean, people, we don't like to be completely ignored. You know, this is the worst form of hostility possible, to completely ignore someone. I don't really ignore anyone. I mean, it doesn't matter who it is. At least I acknowledge, hey, you know, you're a brother in spirit. I know that. And you're having a dream of committing spiritual suicide. I understand. You know, but I don't, at least I acknowledge that you're dreaming, you're doing this. I mean, there's nobody I actually totally ignore at all. So being ignored is a very vicious kind of situation. But I know when you speak truth in this world, you're going to be ignored. So, and I was willing to be ignored to some extent, you know, because of the previous experience I had where I was getting way too much attention. I wanted to create, you know, music. I was composing music and I loved doing that. And I was trying to create more and more beautiful music, and the people kept interrupting me, you know, and I didn't really like that because I was very, very focused. And occasionally I would speak up and make comments and criticize culture, say inconvenient truths. And people say, what the heck are you talking about? Yeah, well, you know, when you're bigger than life figure, then people, you know, they give you a little wiggle room. You know, you can say stuff like Trump is able to say stuff because he's this bigger than life figure, you know. He's bombastic and just, you know, in a lot of ways preposterous, you know, and he's not afraid to flaunt, yeah, I'm rich, you know, I'm richer than you, you know, this is great, and it's just there's an element of theater to it, for sure. So, but you get hounded, and so I got hounded so much, I said, just let me, I just want to live a life, and nobody bothers me at all. And this is what's happened. Nobody bothers me at all. Nobody even asks the time of day from me. I can be like invisible. No matter where I go, nobody pays the slightest bit of attention to me. It's kind of weird, to say the least. I can be at a party and I'll end up in a corner. Nobody, it's like I'm not even there. Not that I want that, really, but this is what happens. So I can leave a party and nobody even knows I left. So some deep down, see, that's what I wanted. I didn't want anyone to pay any attention to me. Now, I don't know if this will continue on or not, but it certainly enables me then to speak this pure, clear truth and not be too bothered that very few people, you know, are paying attention to it. I've been comfortable with that, so that's okay. That's okay. You know, and how else could I done? You know, I have so many videos. How else could I keep doing these videos and there's very little, you know, attention? I say, very few are listening. No, very little feedback. You know, very little of this. Very little. I say, well, that's fine. It's okay. I'm not bothered by it. You know, just a few. You know, that's enough. You know, I have there are those, like, you know, 50 views or something, or 50 to 100 views. I say, that's okay. Whereas the effort, you know, most people put all this massive effort, and they say that's preposterous. There's, you know, I'm not going to keep doing this. It's ridiculous. But for me, I say, that's fine. That's fine. I don't want a bunch of people hounding me. You know, I've been there and done that. So it's amazing how these things work out. Now, I said, Jesus is back. There's no question, he is back, and he just walked into my house in this dream. Just walked in, and I said, this is great, but where's your wounds? You know, I sort of hallucinated. I imagined they must be there, but I thought you must be near death. You know, oh my gosh, are you okay? You've come back from a severe sickness or illness, or wait. I was looking for signs of, you know, fragility and all this kind of stuff, and I was assuming that it was there, so I was kind of imagining it was, but it really didn't seem to be there at all. I was like, wow, what's going on here? So if you want to be ignored, just say that Jesus has already come back. Everybody will ignore you. that's the ultimate. I mean, if you're being hounded, just stand up, say, hey, everybody, Jesus has come back, and I'm meeting with Jesus, and he's going to come visit me soon. And they'll just say, okay, and walk the other way. Like walking past a cemetery, you know, you don't want to run, but you kind of like, you wish you could, you know. It's like, and then as soon as you get out of sight of somebody, then you run as fast as possible. Oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. There's a crazy there, there's a crazy, there's a crazy. And this is what they're saying. Oh my gosh, the crazies. I think Senator McCain said, Trump is bringing out all the crazies. All the crazies are coming out. You know, this is what they're panicking. The crazies are coming out. You know, people who have half a mind left, or at least they have a little bit of the mind left. They can actually see a little bit. The crazies. You know, the crazies are coming back. This is terrible. We thought we dumbed everybody down. I said, yeah, I'm a war hero. You've got to be dumbed down. I say, you got to be dumbed down. You got to be dumbed down. You got to do what a war hero asks you to do, right? And he says, the crazies are coming back. Oh my God, the crazies are coming. And this is this is their mode. And then they're saying, wait, maybe they're not crazies. Maybe they're clowns. I'm not sure. They're like clowns. Yeah, maybe they're clowns. Crazy clowns. The crazy clowns are here. And there's all this theater about it, you know, the theater about it. And it's almost like the theater of the absurd, but not quite. It's the apocalypse. It's the lifting of the veil. You know, Greece had their turmoil, and we'll see how that goes. But the United States is now having its turmoil. Because they just don't know what to do. Say, well, let's move all this to the entertainment section, is what the Huffington Post said. Let's just move it all to the entertainment section. It doesn't exist. It's not really happening. And politically, it's not happening at all. You know, it's just complete denial that it's even happening. It's just a reality TV show. That's what it is. It must be just all for reality TV. It's all make-believe here. The apocalypse isn't happening. You know, that's what they're saying. No, apocalypse isn't happening. So they squelched Greece, okay. You know, then they try to stuff those inconvenient truths back away as quickly as possible, right? You know, trying to turn Greek into like a permanent serfdom, state of Greece, turning them all into slaves, indebted slaves. That's what the banksters want, actually. That's what they've done to a lot of third world countries. I mean, they have their ways of taking over the world economically and financially. And so these truths were being raised, you see. Now, you could say that Edward Snowden started it with the, you know, and the WikiLeaks started the apocalypse too. Julian Assange, you know, Edward Snowden, these characters, these are actors too. You know, they start saying, hey, wait a minute, we're all being spied upon. You know, what if they had not said anything? Would we even know what's going on? No, we wouldn't, would we? But they released the fact that everyone's being massively spied upon. These companies are reading all our emails. Everything we say, everything we do online is being collected, is being spied upon. Gee, you know, inconvenient truth there. And of course, their feathers got ruffled, very much ruffled there, didn't it? Yeah. You can't say that. Yeah, what do you mean? No, we need that. We need to do that in order to diminish, you know, to diminish everyone to the point where we finally find the sufferer. You know, we just haven't located the sufferer yet, so we got to make sure we diminish. If we haven't diminished ourselves enough, let's pretend to be even more diminished. You know, where we're completely in lockdown. You know, lockdown mode. Every last scrap of information is about us is known. We're profiled, we're on lists, and we're ready to, you know, round them up and, you know, control every last thing, word we do, and nobody can say a word that, you know, let's diminish our freedom, so we finally can convince guilt that, you know, spirit can convince guilt that spirit's died. Look, got no freedom at all. It must have died, right? This isn't spirit anymore, this is something else. So spirit is trying to show this something else. This world is that something else. Spirit's saying, look at this world, guilt. It's obvious I've died. It's obvious I've died. How could there be this world if I hadn't died? It's impossible. I could never have made this world. So I must have died. This is the evidence of my death. This world is really what we hope to be the evidence of our death, the death of spirit. Being presented to guilt, so guilt will say, oh, okay, I did get my revenge on spirit, and so I'm now, my revenge has been satisfied. My revenge has been satisfied. My appetite for revenge has been completely satisfied. So now I'm just going to go to sleep, you know. And then the spirit will say, okay, great. Finally, guilt is gone. Now we can enjoy, you know, our status as greater than God. That's it. This is all that's happening. And it's such a shock, I can't even remember what I just said. But, you know, that's fine. Because this means it hit home. It means it hit home very strongly. So when you can't remember what you just said, that means you're in the wow. So don't get mad. Don't try to remember what you said. Just say, thank God. Thank you, God. That's just tremendous. Love it. Now, like McCain, for instance, did he serve honorably? Absolutely. At least, unless there's evidence that proves otherwise, that he was a snitch. But, you know, we'll give him the benefit of the doubt at this point. And say he served honorably. Fine. He was unlucky. Yeah, he got shot down. It's unlucky. Okay. It happens. Happens to a lot of people. There's a lot of bad, quote-unquote, bad luck in war. Okay. Some take a bullet. Some don't. He got shot down. Spent time in a prisoner camp. Okay, well, so he served honorably. But is that really a hero? What exactly did he do? Did he win some great battles? Did he come up with did he save a whole bunch of soldiers on the front? And did he? I mean, what exactly constitutes heroic action? And isn't that usually somebody who shoots down 20 of the enemy's planes or conducts a very successful raid, or many raids, or does something that is tremendously effective, right? That's a war hero. Someone who does something very effective. Like if they're a sniper, they have they shoot all these kills, and or they do a great evacuation of a city that's about to be overrun, and they're able to save thousands, hundreds of thousands of lives. Or they go out and rescue fallen comrades, great many of them. Or they jump on a bomb that was intended for someone else, and it goes off, and they save the other ones. That's a hero, okay. But getting shot down doesn't make you a hero, and the fact that you get tortured while you're in jail doesn't necessarily make you a hero. It means that you served honorably. You know, if you didn't break, and that's fine. Absolutely. Nothing wrong with that, but serving honorably. But it doesn't make you a war hero. And so he's using this war hero claim status to get people to go along with his agenda. And he's really not who he's pretended to be at all. And there's a lot of people, we know that. We already know that. He already ran for president. Good grief, you could see that he was basically just a patsy, you know. And his politics are not what many people think they are at all. So this is being brought to light, but many already know this. We already know this, you know. And so, but some candidates spoke this. You said, "Oh my God, you just broke one of the Ten Commandments," you know. You can't do that. You can't say that, you know. Well, we say, well, what's the big deal? We already know that, you know. We know he inflated his status. He's a status inflator. There's no question about it. He loves the idea of playing the hero. I'm this great American hero, which is simply not true at all. You know, he served honorably and that's it. Well, I got injured, you know. Well, you know, guess what? A lot of people get injured and maimed in war, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You don't hear them making claims to be some extraordinary hero. I mean, there's thousands and maybe hundreds of thousands of veterans that went through more than he did, and various, you know, traumas or whatever. You know, they're not out there saying, "Hey, look at me, I'm a great American hero." And most of them are quiet. My dad went through, did a tremendous amount of awesome work in the war, World War II, actually. He never, outside the family, never told anybody. And he only mentioned like once or twice to us. He said, "No, I don't want any recognition for it at all. I don't want." Many veterans from World War II are that way. He saved lives. He was so skillful, such a war hero, that he was chosen to fly MacArthur's honor guard into Tokyo for the surrender of Japanese. One of, I think, 20 pilots that was chosen because of his extraordinary service during the war. He never told anybody, except he mentioned, I think, like I said, one occasion he talked about the war. He didn't want to talk about it at all. He said, "It's like a dream, that like nightmare. I don't want to talk about it all." But McCain, all he's done is talk about what a great war hero he is. You know, that's very unseemly, actually. Very unseemly. And he, as if we're supposed to then agree with his politics and his policies and what he's telling us. You know, stick your head in the sand. No, we don't have to agree with it. That's ridiculous. Like I said, my dad was way more of a war hero than McCain ever was, and I, you know. So why should I bow? You know, bow to me? It's ridiculous. Okay, and so Trump's just saying, "Hey, wake up, folks. You know, come on, let's not be hijacked by this guy who's claiming he's a war hero. So we have to do what he says. That's preposterous." Now, if you had said, "Hey, you're my dad, you're a big war hero," he said, no. In fact, they tried to turn him into, the Air Force wanted him to be a symbol, like they wanted to play him up as a war hero after the war. And he said, "Forget it. I don't want to be a hero. I don't want to be a war hero." And walked away from it. Walked away from it and said, I hate war, you know. I mean, it's terrible. I don't want to be a war hero." And he was adamantly against that. Adamantly against it. And so this is you know, these things are being brought to light. This is the apocalypse, and things are being brought to light. This is the time when everything gets brought to light, you see. And you just take as much as you can of it. And unfortunately, these lemmings, you call them liberal lemmings, but they're cave dwellers, are in, you know, full cave dweller mode. They've gone caveman on us. Caveman and cavewoman on us. They said, "No, we want to retreat back in, you know, into the..." So they're retreating back deeper into the cave, you know. It's like, "Oh my God, I see some... What is that? Oh, there's a raging fire out there. Oh my God, what do we do? How do you put it out? Oh, our water won't put it out. Oh, let's retreat back into the cave. There must be some deeper areas of the cave. Let's go." And so they're frantically running back into the back of the cave and looking for some passageway that will open up to some deeper, darker area of the cave where there's no light that can ever shine there. This is what's happening. That's very sad, you know. We certainly don't want that for any of them. But it's the apocalypse. This is when the light, Jesus has returned. The light of the world has returned. The light of truth has returned to the world. And so it is what it is. There's no way around it. So don't be one of those cave dwellers searching for some deeper place to dwell. Because, you know, at some point you're going to look around and say, wow, I don't really feel so comfortable here, you know. This isn't really working out so well for me. So, you know, at all costs, don't go running back in the cave. Don't be stampeded by the cave dwellers. And as far as the actors and actresses, whatever's going on, you know, yeah, it is what it is. You know, it's part of the apocalypse. Just part of it. You know. And if you say, well, I want something better, oh, well, here's something better right here. I'll speak even more preposterously than Trump could even imagine speaking. You know. I already have. Jesus is back. You know. How preposterous can you get? People say, it's crazy. You know, if Jesus was back, we would know about it. Well, who would know about it? You see, who would know about it, right? How would you know about it? Well, what did Jesus do? He simply said, I'm back. So, you would hear it. I was willing to listen to it. I was willing to say, well, that's not so preposterous. I've been expecting it. And I was ready for it. I was ready to absorb the shock of that, having worked and worked and worked and worked my whole life on that. So, the ones who say it's preposterous, well, they just didn't listen. They haven't listened yet, but hopefully they will. And we don't have to pay attention to, you know, the minor stuff of the apocalypse. This stuff is pretty minor, the political stuff. It's, a lot of people are really, you know, engrossed into it. Well, that's where they're at. That's fine. But there's a much bigger story, and that's Jesus is back. It's much bigger than, you know, who's going to be president. It doesn't matter who's going to be president. If we ever get to that, I don't believe we'll even get to that. I don't believe we even have an election in 2016. I think the collapse, the very situations will happen before the election, and likely martial law or something. I don't think we'll have an election in 2016. And you know, maybe Trump knows that, and he's just trying to bring to light as much stuff as possible, as fast as possible. Because people say, well, he's not going to really run, or he can't really be elected. Well, maybe that's not the point of it. Maybe there isn't going to be any election. So the point of right now is the apocalypse is to bring everything to light, bring it all to light. Now, back in the 60s, we had that happen with, we brought corporate culture, the military-industrial complex, we started bringing that to light. Some are still, you know, working on that, but they don't realize that there's a bigger picture than that. And so they're kind of, have gotten pulled into being cave dwellers. They kind of say, no, wait a minute, you know, we want all the attention to be on what we're bringing to light. But they overlooked the bigger picture. So in some regards, they're being obstructionist at this point, which is too bad, because I was certainly one of those who worked very hard to bring the corporate military industrial complex to light, and all of that stuff to light. I was very supportive of that. But I said, hey, it doesn't stop there. You know, there's a bigger picture. Jesus is coming back. And we're going to bring all the spiritual shenanigans to light, religious shenanigans, egoic shenanigans, the whole thing, the whole preposterous thing of spirit pretending to commit suicide. We're going to bring that to light. But they stop right with their, hey, let's attack Monsanto. Let's, you know, do this. They're still in that old, you know, vibe of outing. That's all been outed, really. You know, I mean, we get it. They haven't got with the new narrative. I mean, the bigger picture yet. And so they're trying to ignore it, basically. I mean, nobody's been mean to me at all. But they, unless you say ignoring it's being mean, and you could say that. You could say that, right? But hopefully that's not the case. Because, I mean, I'm very simpatico with, you know, the apocalypse, and they certainly played a role in that, and I thank them for that. You know, I thank my generation for the role that it played, but they ran out of gas, you know. I didn't. There's a difference. Well, I did, but I kept going. I pushed the car. You know, the car ran out of gas, but then I started pushing it, which was difficult work. But the, you know, the bigger picture is cosmic corporate culture, for example, and even beyond that is, again, spirit. This whole thing is pretense. And so some have helped out cosmic corporate culture. There have been some, and I've been very much part of that. And I thank everyone who has done that. But they also stopped short. They said, okay, we've outed, you know, the extraterrestrials, what they've been doing here. And this, that was, that's been a big push for last, you know, 30, 40, actually, go back to Roswell, which has been like, what, about 60 years. And so I've been heavily involved in that my whole life, outing the, you know, the corporate brainwashing of the planet, which was 60s or heavily in 60s and was heavily involved in that late 50s, 60s, 70s, and outing the meddling in this world, the takeover of this world by extraterrestrials, cosmic corporate culture. I've been heavily involved in that, but even more importantly, I've been even more heavily involved in the return of Jesus here, the return of Christ here. That is the real story, actually. This is the real preposterousness. You know, this is the real apocalypse, is lifting the veil on the fact this is all a preposterous dream of spirit pretending to commit suicide. And yet that pretense has not touched spirit in the slightest bit. In fact, spirit has never suffered one bit from this dream at all. Has never suffered fatigue, tiredness, depression, despair, confusion, fear, nothing. Has never experienced any of that. These are just dream symptoms. Dream symptoms is all that it is. All of this is. There is no sufferer. We'll never find a sufferer. Period. Now, I hope that those who have worked somewhat in outing things, you know, and then bringing the apocalypse, will get with the greater apocalypse here, you know, get with the big picture here. But it's not happening yet. It's not happening yet. They seem to be somewhat stuck. And a lot of them are actually outraged that what they did isn't the final thing. Because they hoped it would be. They hoped they could avoid, you know, the extra work. You know, and now they're seeing it, they're realizing it wasn't enough. They didn't solve the problems. And they're very, a lot of the liberals have become very reactionary and turned into extreme cave dwellers, which is very sad. And I've been telling them all along, hey, this will happen to you. If you don't keep going, this is what's going to happen to you. You're actually going to be turned into the very type of corporate, you know, control that you are so much against. But it'll be a bigger corporate control, and you won't even realize it. You'll end up being a patsy. You know, the very thing that you worked against, you'll end up being getting fooled again and actually be a big supporter of that, which is exactly what's happened. Now they're supporting cosmic corporate culture as saying, you know, this will help the pretense succeed. They didn't get to the real spiritual truth at all. Now, a lot of them dabbled in it, you know. Sure, we're going to do some yoga. You know, let's do yoga. You know, the dabbler, there's a lot of dabblers. Say, oh yeah, we got the spirituality thing covered. Don't worry, we got it covered. That's what it's really about. Let's be honest, pop spirituality is all about, you know, basically saying, no, we don't have to hear that preposterous stuff. No, what do you mean? We got the spirituality thing covered. We go to yoga class, and were kind of into it. And I think we read some book, you know, maybe, or someone told me about a book, and that's good enough. We got it covered. That's what they're trying to assert. So their minds are going to be blown, you know. I mean, so they'll just, you know, unfortunately, they just go into retreats because they, you know, they don't have it covered. They've been so busy, you know, outing the small picture, which they did a good job at, but they wanted to think this is it, you know. But so it was kind of a compensatory sort of thing. They say, hey, if we do this, then we don't have to do that. And then they're finding out now that they do have to do that. They say, no, that's not fair, that's not fair, that's not fair. That's too much, asking too much of us. So spirituality, okay, we got that covered. No, I don't want to hear anything more. I go to yoga class, that's it. We'll have International Yoga Day, that's it. We'll get everybody in Rishikesh, that's it. We'll sit on the banks of the Ganges in a lotus, full, half lotus or full lotus posture, and we'll listen to the water and say, oh, that's very peaceful and relaxing. Okay, that's it. Got it covered. Nothing else to see here. Nothing else to see here. Full asana. Full lotus asana. In Rishikesh on the banks of the Ganges. We got it covered. And maybe there's some pundit there saying some things. Like, you're so wonderful. Thank you for being here. Straight from the heart. Love from the heart. Yes. We got it covered. We got it covered. So what I experience is most of the spirituality that has arisen comes from people who really have their attention somewhere else, lifting the veil on certain aspects of the stream. And they want the recognition. They want to be war heroes, basically. Apocalyptic heroes, heroes of the apocalypse. And they're realizing, wait a minute, I think we came up short. And they don't want anyone to know that. So they're saying the spirituality thing is where I came up short, right? Oh, yeah, okay, well, oh God, how do I get this covered, you know? So kind of, there's like a whole bunch of John McCain's running around. But they're all saying, well, we're, you know, New Age heroes. We're whistleblower heroes. You know, we're heroes of the apocalypse. We lifted the veil on Monsanto or something, you know. And they don't want, and they want the medals, you know. They want everyone to bow and worship them. Say, oh my gosh, aren't you wonderful? Yeah, what are your orders? We'll follow, do whatever you say. So they're trying to cover this spiritual, you know, apocalypse that has to take place. They're trying to say, no, we got it covered. We got it covered. I just went and saw a guru. I just went to Rishikesh. I saw a guru. That covers it. Now let's get back to Monsanto, you know. And they don't understand. And as I say to them, you served honorably, thank you. But you're not heroes of the apocalypse. Okay, you're not true heroes of the apocalypse. True heroes of the apocalypse are those who are truly effective in lifting the veil on this complete pretense. This is spirit pretending to commit suicide. It's nothing other than that. It is absolutely nothing other than that. There is no suffer. There never has been. All the suffering is just a dream of symptoms, but there's no sufferer. And we're doing this merely to try and satisfy what we think is the revenge, this variable revenge we call guilt, that is demanding our death. Since we think we killed God, now we have this demand for our death. So we're pretending to die. We're pretending to commit suicide, which we think will satisfy the appetite of revenge, of guilt, so that guilt will be satisfied and will no longer be seeking revenge, and then we can live happily ever after as being greater than God. This is exactly it as it is. This is exactly as it is. I don't take any delight in admonishing people at all. You know, those who are trying to, you know, cover the spirituality by, you know, so they can pretend that they're heroes of the apocalypse. No, I mean they served honorably. This is my opinion of, for instance, of liberals. They served honorably. They did bring a lot of stuff to light. You know, they did some work. There's no question about it. And I thank them for that. You know, but in their zeal to be seen as heroes of the apocalypse, they're ending up being, you know, a problem. they're gumming up the works. They're saying, no, spirituality, we've already got that covered. No, we don't need to look any more deeper there. Now let's get back to the politics here, and, you know, and let's get... It's getting in the way. It's getting in the way. I used to be a super liberal, but I realized that they were deciding to stop. I said, you can't stop. What do you mean stop? You got to dig deeper. They said, no. So then I realized, uh-oh. If I keep going with this crowd, I'm going to be fixated, you know? And then I'm going to be dishonest later on, claiming I'm some hero when I'm not. So I had to say, no, I got to get out of this. So I got out of it. Now, when it comes to politics and these various things, what I recommend is you balance so you're not caught up on either side. And so this is what I did. I balanced it all out. Balanced it all out. So... And get past it. Once it's balanced out, you're not pulled one way or the other. You know, you say, no, I'm not pulled this way. I'm not a liberal. I'm not a conservative. I see both viewpoints. They both balance out. And then, poof, you know, you can go deeper that way. So you don't get stuck. You don't get stuck in it. Because both sides really are both claiming that they're heroes, you know, and neither one is. Trump's not really a hero. He's not a hero really either. But it's helping balance things out, which gives us the option, helps people go deeper. Say, wow, wait a minute. This whole political thing is absolutely crazy. It's not working out. And keep in mind that no matter, let's say there was an election in 2016, it's going to either be Clinton or Trump, for instance. Let's just use those examples. Well, you know, there isn't any way that you're going to have a peace in this country. There's no, once this part, the veil has been lifted, it's being lifted more and more and more, neither side is going to be satisfied in the slightest bit, in the slightest bit. So you're not going to heal the country. It's not going to happen. So you should realize you have to go deeper. You have to go deeper now. And you have to get past this facade of spirituality, which the liberals, well, there's both the conservatives and the liberals that put up a facade of spirituality. The traditional religions is a facade of spirituality, let's be honest, for the most part. There's some who've used it to go deeper. I mean, there's some Buddhists who have used Buddhism to go deeper. There's some Christians who use Christianity to go deeper. There's some Muslims who have used Islam to go deeper. There are some Jews who have used Judaism to go deeper, right? There's some Hindus who have used Hinduism to go deeper. Absolutely, that is true. It is absolutely true. Yet the preponderance of it all has been used to put wallpaper, you know, whitewash it, and they say, oh, we got that spirituality thing covered. Now let's work on, you know, let's be this little issue here, and I want to be recognized as a hero, you know. That's the preponderance of it. It's been used that way. And so the conservatives are saying, hey, we got our Jesus, our style of Jesus, and so we're heroes. That's enough. We don't need any more. And then the liberals are saying, well, we got our New Age stuff, you know, and that covers it. We've got it covered. We got spirituality covered even better than you guys do. You know, that kind of thing. That's the back and forth. They say, no, we got it covered better than you because we got Jesus. And they say, no, we got it covered better because we got tolerance or something, whatever they want, you know. We got tolerance. We got it covered. And whatever, you know, we've got yoga pants. We got it covered. And neither one of them have it covered at all. This is just a whitewash. They're just lazy. I mean, they don't want to go any further. And I'd say, if you know, coming up, if you're not actually associating with Jesus, then you don't have it covered. I certainly believe that Jesus is actually going to be associating with us, relating. We'll be aware of it. We'll be aware of it. And that will give the lie to those who claim they've got it covered, when really all they're aiming for is to be seen as heroes of the apocalypse, when they're really not, when they're really just been kind of ran out of gas. And that's why the conservatives are so upset with Trump, saying that McCain's not a real war hero, because a lot of those conservatives think that they're some kind of heroes too. You know, that they've somehow done a lot of work to make this pretense seem more believable, you know, that spirit committed suicide. Jesus died. Jesus became flesh, spirit became flesh, and then spirit, and then the flesh was killed. That means the spirit was killed. I mean, this is the central belief. Yeah. This is, of course, trying to make this work. The spirit is trying to convince guilt that it committed suicide, that it died. But this is all total pretense. Death of a body, the body doesn't die. This is all just a dream. Dream symptoms. Death is just a dream symptom. Dream symptom. In search of a sufferer. In search of one who can die. You know? That's all it is. So did Jesus' body seem to expire, stop breathing? Well, sure, why not? And then Jesus showed us it's just a dream. I can just revive it. The body is a piece of cake. Just like in a dream, you dream someone died in a dream. What can you, if you decide, oh, wait, I want them to be alive again. Well, poof, they're alive again in the dream. It's like that. Did Jesus suffer? Well, the body seemed to give evidence of suffering. There was blood everywhere and everything. But was spirit suffering? No, not in the slightest bit. So spirit then was that what was happening? Spirit was dreaming a dream of symptoms. The symptoms were there. But that's all they are, symptoms. There was no sufferer there. There was, and you know, a lot of those who, you know, superficial Christians want to say, hey, we got this covered, we got this spiritual thing covered. You know, that's their whole thing, is that Jesus suffered and died. That there actually was a sufferer there. And this is mistaken. There's no sufferer there. Never will be. Now, for those who have been believing this, you know, they might say this is preposterous. But there are those, I'm aware there are those who have questioned the whole thing and said, wait a minute, maybe I've been a little lazy here. You know, maybe I've been a little lazy. And maybe, you know, and so you're hearing this, but you're saying, well, this is preposterous. How can you say this? There was no sufferer there. That's the key ingredient. Well, it's the key ingredient to try and deceive guilt. Yeah, it is. But there is no guilt. And it's deception anyway. It's all pretense. It's the key pretense, right? To say that spirit became flesh and then flesh suffered. That there actually was a sufferer. Spirit really was a sufferer. That's the key to our deception, right? That's how we're trying to deceive guilt. And so to see the whole thing and say, oh, why did we believe this? Oh, because we thought for sure this is the way that we have to deceive guilt. We have to believe this. So we keep believing it. You know, we keep believing it, that Jesus suffered and died, became flesh, suffered and died. So there was a sufferer. And we think that this will deceive guilt and satisfy the appetite of guilt. We call this guilt God. You know, think that God is out for revenge and angry at us, and then this Jesus' death satisfied the desire for God's revenge. But it's not God. It's guilt that we're trying to satisfy the guilt, the appetite of guilt for revenge upon us. And so we're believing that this must satisfy, but there isn't any guilt to satisfy. And spirit cannot suffer. So it's a pretense, it's a pretend, and there is no sufferer. Spirit pretended to commit suicide, but it never really happened at all. The spirit did not suffer at all. Spirit did not die at all. And so it's a pretense, and there is no guilt. Both of those, you have to hear this and hear this and hear this. Now, if people are waiting for Jesus to come back to just acknowledge their false beliefs, you know, that's not going to happen. That's why the people aren't realizing he's back already. because he's going to speak the truth. So I was willing to listen to him. I said, yeah, sure, I'll relate with you. What do you have to say? And then he's back and talking. Of course, Jesus is going to tell us the truth. And many, what people are waiting for, many, is someone who's just going to confirm their belief that there was a suffer, that spirit did die and suffer and die. That's what they're waiting for. And there is no such Jesus to come back and confirm that. That's a lie. But we have to forgive ourselves because, you know, we invented this notion of guilt. And we feel like guilt is trying to kill us. So we think we have to convince guilt that it has killed us. So we put up this, you know, total charade, this very clever charade. And to just forgive ourselves, say, okay, this is what we've done. Okay, now I see it. Now I understand why I did this. And say, okay, no biggie, there never was any guilt. It was just all much ado about nothing. And so I don't have to keep doing it. I don't have to keep believing. I don't have to wait for Jesus to confirm this, because that's never going to happen. So I can then get the benefit of the real Jesus, and I can relate with the real Jesus, who will tell us, yeah, no, there's not never saw any suffering. I never suffered. Spirit can't suffer. It was just to point out the charade. I did it to point out the charade for what it was. That's all. And forgive yourself. You've been trying to trick guilt is all, but guilt doesn't exist. You invented it. You didn't change God, so the will of God is perfect. It means that you're still perfect. Very simple. So the reason why most don't know Jesus is already back is because they're looking for a different message. So they may have heard this message and say, well, that's not Jesus, because it's not saying the message that I expect Jesus to say. Whereas I was expecting the message to be what it was. And when I heard, you know, Jesus give this message, say, that I listened to, okay, I'll listen to you. So, oh, okay. Yeah. That's what I expected to hear, because I've already been paying attention to, for instance, A Course in Miracles, which has been much clearer, you know, message of Jesus. Clarified a lot. So people of the world have just ignored it. Ignored Jesus. Said, well, that can't be it, because the message isn't what I expected to hear. This is what's going on right now. Kind of like with Trump, they say, hey, you know, put him on the entertainment page. This isn't a candidate. He's not even a candidate. To a lot of people, this is just a sideshow reality reality TV buffoon who's not even a candidate at all. So they don't even say, well, you know, that doesn't have anything to do with politics. It's not even a candidate. So it's just a joke. Whatever he says is just a joke. I don't have to listen to it at all. And pay attention, just a joke. So a lot of people having the same attitude toward Jesus, they say, that's not Jesus, it's a joke. What do you mean, they would never suffer? That's ridiculous. Half the people say he never existed in the first place, and the other half say that he did suffer and die. That spirit actually suffered and died, you know. And so Jesus saying, no, it's not true. They say, well, this guy's a jokester. He's an idiot. He's a buffoon. He's an attention grabber, you know. I'm not going to pay attention to that. He's a clown. I'm not going to pay attention to it. This is so half saying never existed, so that why pay attention to a fairy tale? The other half is saying, no, this can't possibly be Jesus, because he's not saying what I expect to hear. But he is saying what I expected to hear. Absolutely. So that's why I say, hey, come on in, come visit the house. Are you kidding me? Of course. Even though it is a bit shocking. Pay us a visit. You know, pay us a visit. You're always welcome here. Very welcome here. How we doing? It is recording, right? Okay, great. I've had some troubles recording recently. That's okay. A few bumps in the road, just keep on going. So we're just getting up to speed here. We need to get up to speed on the apocalypse. Getting up to speed on the apocalypse is where it's at right now. Apocalypse means lifting of the veil. I've been saying this for years. It's a lifting of the veil. And you see what's behind the veil. You see what's been hidden. You say, wow, I hadn't seen this before. Or I suspected it would be there, but now I see it more clearly. Keep in mind that the purpose of the world is this pretend fake suicide of spirit. We're trying to convince non-existent guilt that spirit is died. So we're trying to present a picture of such diminishment here that guilt will conclude that, wow, spirit must have died. This couldn't be spirit at all. Spirit couldn't have anything to do with this. You know, no way. But spirit, of course, is always like worried about it. Maybe guilt can tell, because of course spirit can tell. Spirit knows this is all fake. Spirit knows this is all fake. So it's worried that guilt might know it too. So it's desperately trying to make it seem so realistic that, you know, that even spirit is confused. Spirit pretends to be all confused. It's not really confused. That's also a symptom, confusion. That's just another symptom in search of a victim, you know, a dire sufferer, a suicider. Spirit's not really confused. It knows. It knows the truth about the situation. It's all a dream. It's all fake. It's all pretend. It's all pretense. Nothing's ever happened to spirit. It's never suffered. It's never died. It's never been born. It's never aged. It's never suffered any misery whatsoever. No sickness. Never. Spirit's never been sick. Not even the tiniest bit. Never. Never, never, never. All this stuff is just dream symptoms. 100% dream symptoms. Nothing more than that. Nothing more or less than that. So hopefully you're listening attentively to this and you're feeling the wow. And it's like, wow, so this is like preposterous. But on the other hand, you're saying, wow, this is like, also sounds great. You know, it's preposterous, but it sounds great. It sounds like something I've always wanted to hear. But also it sounds like almost preposterous. You know, this is like, what? That's what this is all about. This is what this is about. Don't expect me to not sound almost preposterous. Of course. That's the role here. That's what you get here. And sometimes it might seem over the top, but that just adds to the theater of it. I'm capable of doing a little bit of that. And, you know, this enjoy the theater of it. And that plays some role. Like Trump is using theater. He's saying, what? I'm rich. I'm richer than you. Just it is what it is. Let's cut through all the nonsense. You know, oh, Clinton raised $47 million. Well, so what? I got $10 billion. I'm really, really rich. I mean, let's cut through the nonsense. I mean, okay. Let's stop talking about this idiocy. I mean, this is what it is. And some people are like absolutely appalled at this, you know, and other people just laugh. You think this is great theater. It's funny. It's funny theater. I mean, yeah. Why, if you're rich, why not say it? Yeah, I am rich. If you know the truth, why not say it? Yeah, I know the truth. Some people will think that's great. Yeah, it is true. Others will say, how dare you be so arrogant? How egotistical to say that. That's awful. You know, of course, they're desperately trying to raise more money than you, you know. And they say, it's not fair. It's not fair. We want to be the heroes of the apocalypse, and we want to claim that we've got it all covered, and our cover's being blown. That's awful. Terrible. We're too lazy. We can't be the real heroes because we're too lazy. No, nobody's too lazy. It's just a matter of doing it, of working at it. Yeah, but everybody will think I'm preposterous. Well, there's the problem, right? They don't want to seem to be preposterous. They don't have the guts, the courage to seem to be preposterous. Because if they speak up and speak the truth, people will think they're preposterous. They won't think they're heroes, they'll think they're preposterous. And so they're afraid of that. They don't have the, what can you say? They're not quite determined enough, which is understandable. They don't want to be ignored. That's understandable. I had a situation where I was willing to be ignored because of the previous life where I had too much attention. I didn't like it. So I can understand it. Somebody doesn't want to be ignored. They don't want to seem to be preposterous, so they're not going to do it. But that doesn't mean they can't listen to somebody else who is doing it. So I'm willing to do that. I'm willing to sound preposterous, over the top preposterous. So by all means, there should be those who say, well, I can't quite do that, but I'm certainly willing to listen to it. That's the next best thing. And that's sufficient. That's sufficient. It's sufficient. Because keep in mind that being a listener to a hero of the apocalypse, that too is a hero of the apocalypse. There's two ways to be a hero of the apocalypse. One is to be the leader, so to the up front, like I'm being. And the other is to be the listener and to go through the wow of it. That's also a hero of the apocalypse. There's two ways to do it. You've got to have someone who talks, someone who listens. Two sides of one coin, actually. I realize my name, Ross, I believe it's actually, was sort of twisted a little bit, anglicized. It's Rosh, R-O-S-H, Rosh. Rosh means the head, the best part, the chief, the leader, the first, the top of the mountain, the first, Rosh Hashanah, the first day of the Jewish New Year. It's a Jewish word that can be a name, and it came out as Ross, but Rosh. I believe that the real reference to me is R-O-S-H, which describes my role, actually, in a Jewish way, Jewish using Hebrew word to describe what my role actually is, to be prominent, to be like the top of the mountain, give the very best. It also means to give the very best of, to be the leader of the tribe, the chief, give the very best of, the top of the mountain, the head, you know, that which is on top of the situation. And so I'm giving the very best of, you know, truth to the world. That's my role. But being a listener, hearing this, and that's also a hero of the apocalypse. Anyone who succeeds in lifting the veil is a hero of the apocalypse, absolutely. And in order to do that, you have to hear truth. You have to hear it. I'm hearing it myself as I say this, too. So I'm actually a listener too. I'm a very good listener. I listen to Jesus. I've been listening to Jesus for a long time. So I'm an exceptional listener. Or as Trump would say, I'm a great listener. Which is true. I'm a great listener. I'm a super great listener. One of the best. One of the best for sure. And so I'm able to now speak it. And but at the same time I'm speaking, I'm being shocked too. I'm being shocked, but I'm used to it enough so I'm still able to speak it. You know, but sometimes I can't. I forget what I was going to say because I'm so shocked by what I just said. I said, oh my gosh, I just too much wow, you know. Or not too much, but a lot. Too much is just enough. Get as much wow in here as we can. Get as much cowbell as we can. The cowbell of wow. I'm under terrible pressure to get this out. I mean, it's just that I'm under this, the apocalypse, the collapsing, the frustration. Everybody's just boiling over. They don't know, you know, where to go, what to do, how can they be a hero? They don't want to be left behind. They don't want to be cave dwellers, but they're caught in this, you know, papering over effect of dilettante, spiritual dilettantism. I got this covered spirituality. Don't worry, I got this covered, you know, that kind of thing. They're stuck in that. They're stuck in it. And they pray to the goddess. The goddess will say, oh, sure, you've done enough. Sure, you've done enough. You shouldn't be expected to do any more. That's not fair. You know, you've done enough. Just worship me, and I'll tell Jesus that you've done enough, and he'll have to say, okay, is that really true? Really? So you stay deluded, and that's you've done enough? How is that doing enough? How is that ever going to work out for you? It doesn't work out for you. You can't go to Jesus and say, hey, Jesus, I've done enough. And Jesus say, well, have you awoken and realized that, you know, what this is all about? And you've truly repented, and have, you know, are you fully awake and abiding in the complete resolution of the whole thing, non-dualness? And say, no, and we say, oh, no, I'm just doing my yoga in Rishikesh, but you know, the goddess said, that's enough. Didn't she tell you that? And Jesus said, well, she tried, you know, but I had to admonish her, saying, this is nonsense. That's not love, it's hate. You know, keeping yourself deluded in this pretend suicide, that's not what you really want at all. You have to set this down with a laugh. You know, you've got to go all the way. So I had to admonish the goddess to stop pretending like she's helping you, because she's not. That too is just something that's made up. The goddess, this is something we just made up completely. Imagine that there's some such cause that can say, yeah, we can fake our own spiritual suicide and keep dwelling in that fakery and still be completely happy. In other words, we can fool guilt. We'll do it. This we should have done enough to fool guilt. And the goddess says, don't worry. I'll talk to guilt and convince guilt that this, he really did die. The spirit really did die. And then guilt will believe me. See, he's not believing Jesus, but guilt will believe me. And we say, okay, goddess, thank you so much. Because I'm so, you know, I just don't know what to do, you know. I just don't know what to do. I it doesn't seem to be working. I feel so diminished and so feel so terrible. And Jesus doesn't seem to understand what, you know, I believe in Jesus, but it hasn't worked. What's the problem? And God says, don't worry, I'll go talk to guilt for you. I'll go talk to God, you know, guilt, and say, hey, guilt, it really is true that spirit really did die. I mean, I know because I'm associating with it. I can tell that, you know, yeah. It's just guilt. Spirit isn't the same, you know. I had this relationship with spirit. Now spirit isn't it anymore. It's just bodies. And really, spirit really did die. Guilt. You know. So the goddess goes to guilt, and we send her there, and we think that she's going to convince guilt. But of course, there isn't any guilt there at all. She's just talking to nothing. It doesn't make much sense, does it? How can you convince nothing of anything? So what good is the goddess actually? No good at all. No good at all. Again, that's just saying, we got this covered. We got that covered. We got this covered. Nothing to see here, you know. Now let's get back to bashing, you know, somebody. You know. You're making us feel uncomfortable. Let's go bash, you know. Got the spirituality covered. No worries. And then someone comes along saying, talking like me, completely preposterous, and say, what are you talking about? We got it all covered. Well, you're an idiot. You completely, this is preposterous. We already have this covered. Nothing to see here. Nothing to hear here. We got this covered. How do you convince nothing of something? Now we got that covered. The goddess got that covered. How's the goddess convince nothing of anything? How do you convince nothing of anything? Well, that's the goddess's specialty. We don't know how she does it, but she's able to do it. Really? Who gave her that capability? Convince nothing of something. Well, God did. Really? How does God do that? That's not something. God, there isn't any such thing as nothing. So how could God? That's preposterous. That's preposterous, right? That God created some ability of us to convince nothing of something? Why would God do that? You know, start asking these inconvenient questions. Well, I don't know. Just she's able to do it. Is she able to do it? Or are we hoping that she's able to do it? Are you hoping that based on desperation? Like a reasonable would say it's preposterous, right? So then we'd have to look for another cause for why we believe in this. It's just sheer desperation, right? Because nothing seems to have worked. So let's hear the gospel truth of Jesus. And Jesus says there is no guilt. So you could hardly convince nothing that you've died, that spirit has died. Who do we convince? Even if spirit had died, who do we convince? Nothing? How do you convince nothing? It's preposterous. And on top of that, spirit can't die. So you basically sent the goddess on mission impossible. And so the goddess can't be a hero, heroine. It's impossible. You can hardly be a heroine when you're trying to accomplish the impossible, because you certainly can only fail. You can only fail. I guess if you hang out in the prison of failure for long enough, you can claim you're a hero or a heroine. but it doesn't make it so. Mission still is not accomplished. So Jesus is the real hero, because he says that there isn't anything to accomplish. You don't need to accomplish anything. You don't need to trick guilt into believing that spirit has died, because there is no guilt. So you hardly need to keep on pretending that, you know, pretending that spirit's committed suicide. I mean, spirit doesn't need to keep pretending that it's committed suicide, because there isn't any guilt there to apply it to, you know. There's no application for it. There's never been any guilt. There's never been anything that demanded our death. We just made that up. That's the hero, the one that tells us the truth. Jesus is the hero of the apocalypse. And those who are helping Jesus also are the heroes or heroines of the apocalypse, absolutely. We'll just use the singular term, hero. Encompasses everyone. So let's be the heroes of the apocalypse. I said, I don't need to do anything. That's the realization that I don't need to do anything at all. There's nothing I need to do. That's the hero of the apocalypse. That's the real lifting of the veil. We lift the veil and say, oh my gosh, there's nothing I need to do at all. There never has been. And nobody needs to do anything. No aspect of spirit needs to do anything at all. There isn't any guilt at all. So no matter what you do, there's nothing to apply it to. No matter what kind of pretense we come up with, there's nothing to apply it to at all. There's no application at all. None. No need to apply it either. We didn't change God. We didn't do anything. It's impossible. So a lot of people are expecting Jesus to come back as some great warrior with bands of angels and destroy all those people who are disagreeing with them and etc. And they're waiting for that. And Jesus comes back, doesn't do anything. He says, I'm here. I just want to hang out and relate with you as friends. Have a good laugh. Yeah, that's all. Because there's nothing that needs to be done. Except, you might say, those need to speak up and sound preposterous to others. Just share the gospel that nothing needs to be done. You could say that's the only thing that needs to be done, is the gospel that nothing needs to be done needs to be shared. And the role of some speak it, a few are called teachers of God, they do the sharing. Others complete the sharing by listening and hearing it and waking up from saying, wow, yeah, that completes the sharing. Sharing is in two parts. Just like a teacher's two parts. This teacher and student is one whole, actually. If there's no students, how can there be a teacher, really? It's ineffective. Although in this case, even though some may not be listening, it's still going into all minds are hearing this, actually. So it is being shared. There's many who are pretending not to listen. They say, that's ridiculous. That's preposterous. Every day in California is a different weather. It's really something. Every day is wonderful, but it's all different. We're just getting like this vast variety. Today's like this sort of a somewhat soft, muggy, cloudy day. I mean, it's just very different than yesterday and the day before. Every day it seems to be different. It's very, quite amazing. Getting a potpourri. But all of it is wonderful. It's just wonderful. The day that cicada started up. Must have reached a certain temperature. Decided time to start singing my song. It's kind of like the apocalypse, time to start singing our song. It starts heating up enough and it's time to start. So, Now, I've been visited in spirit by teachers of truth before, but and I've said I have, you know, brought up to light, and but it didn't actually reach, you know, this very superficial level that we're at now, the level of extreme pretense. But this one I believe will. I'm working to make it so. So it actually becomes a experience during my conscious when I'm in this, you know, waking sleep where I'm moving around day, where I become aware of Jesus' presence and be able to relate to him, not just in a very light dream, but as I'm in this waking dream too. And then, of course, people will say, "Well, it's preposterous. You know, who's this? You know, what is this?" Preposterousness is someone saying that they're relating with Jesus and talking with Jesus, and Jesus is right here, and what are they talking about? We don't see anything. This is preposterous. You know, that will, you know, probably be there to some extent. I don't know. Maybe not some. Most people just ignore it. Some will say it's preposterous, or some will try, of course, to divert the attention to some, to say that they're heroes, they're the real heroes, you know. Again, they have this war hero mentality. You got to be very careful of that. They'll say, "Wow, I've done enough. I've been in prison for so long. I've done enough. I'm the real hero here. Give me attention. But, you know, this has to be pointed out. This is the time for real heroism to arise right now. Okay, so we got to go for that. And let's not get stuck in just honorable service here, which I acknowledge. There have been some who have certainly served honorably in a lot of ways. Okay, but now it's time to go all the way, you know, and be truly heroic, be heroes of the apocalypse, not heroes of the pre-apocalypse, heroes of the apocalypse. So I'm aware of that, and like I said, it's okay. I honor those who are a little bit stuck, you know, but I'm not fooled by it, not intimidated by it, or not going to stop because of it, you know, just because they're saying, you know, crying like, I want the attention, you know. You know, well, if you want the attention, then, you know, start speaking up the right way and speaking the truth of the situation. And you know, do your job. Play your role. Know your role and do it. Let me do my role. It's very simple. But we certainly cannot wait any longer. I mean, the cat's out of the bag, really, right? It's out of the bag. Things are not going to, you know, go back to normal. I mean, even if they stuff Trump, just like they stuff Greece, they're trying desperately to stuff him. Desperately. They're trying to pull the plug on him. Absolutely they are. And, you know, I got to keep doing my role. I cannot jump into that and try to help out. I got my role I got to do. So I don't know if they'll pull the plug or not, how long it'll take them to pull the plug. They, you know, they pulled the plug on Greece. Took them a while, right? So you'd think eventually they'd pull the plug on Trump. You'd expect that. I mean, most people could only take so much. You know, the Lilliputians are tying him down one string at a time as fast as possible. He's the terrible Gulliver the Lilliputians are so afraid of. You know, they got to tie this monster down. It's Godzilla, you know. It's like Godzilla to them. You know, fire-breathing dragon is like invading their, you know, cities. Oh my gosh. All the diminishment we worked so hard for. Now he's saying, wait a minute, we're going to make America great again. You know, they say, what? No, we worked so hard to diminish everything, you know, to please guilt. Oh my gosh, we got to convince guilt that we spirit has died and we can't make America great again. That's terrible. So here comes Godzilla. So all the helicopters are, you know, buzzing, flying around, the planes and helicopters are buzzing around Godzilla, firing, you know, trying to bring Godzilla down. And you'd expect at some point they would bring him down. You know, he's taken so much flak. You know, how much flak can a plane take? They're just going to, you know, they've got the pitchforks and torches out and the hoods, and they're coming after me big time. Out of the shadows, you know, the shadow people, the cave dwellers are got their torches and pitchforks from every angle. So that just plays out, how it'll play out, you know. But meanwhile, they don't realize it, that they've been exposed. This is what they're so upset about. In their very reaction to it all, they've been exposed. They've brought themselves into the light and said, people can see, you know, what where they're really at. Like the Huffington Post, been exposed now, you know. They can't really put that cat back in the bag. You know, they're, you know, just, you know, extraordinarily fearful, intolerant minds that can't even stand the notion. You know, they have to treat it all as a joke. There's no other way their minds can handle it. So that's been brought to light. And this is what, you know, those people are like. A lot of those people, they simply cannot tolerate anything other than their narrative. They're super fragile and rigid and fragile, super rigid and fragile. It's like cave dwellers who cannot stand any light. They've been in the cave so long, they just say, I can't tolerate any of it. Got to make sure the light it doesn't come in the cave at all. But this is a fundamentally untenable position, always will be. So, you know, and this is not the will of God that we remain in this trying to pretend to commit suicide forever. It's not the will of God. So God does pressure us to, hey, recognize what's going on, recognize the pretense, recognize there's no guilt, and get back to enjoying creation as you were created to. So God, there is pressure on us. And so those who say, look, you got to accept the light, they're in the right by doing that. They're in the right. They have a right to do so, absolutely. Now, others can ignore them if they want. They have the right to do that. But still, the gospel will continually be preached. The gospel will always be preached in some way, you know, however the Holy Spirit wants to get through. So the cave dwellers are always nervous, like, when's the next window going to open up? We never know, you know. Where's it going? Let's plaster the cave over like some dark cistern and make sure there's no leaks, no cracks. You know, they're constantly vigilant, any leaks and cracks. A little bit of light might seep in. And they say, oh God, no, where's it going to be next? I never know where it's going to come from. That's not a very happy existence. They're constantly on guard. They think, oh, they're going to have a utopia. But in truth is, they'll be frantically, constantly on guard. That's why all this spying and high-tech is being used, is they want to monitor everything for where the next crack might be. They want to find the cracks, like, immediately and then snuff them out as fast as possible. And they're constantly dedicated to this. So their life is really like a dream of paranoia. They're, like, super paranoid. Phobic, super phobic. The super phobic paranoids, that's what their life is like. Because, you know, the more complex their defenses come, the more worry, more cracks that could possible be, you know. It gets more and more complicated. They have to develop more and more computers to try and handle all the information. Like, where is it coming from next? Dreadful existence. Dreadful, dreadful, dreadful. They try to amuse themselves in the dark, dark dungeon, cave, cistern. That's why Judah said to his brothers, hey, look, let's not leave Joseph here in the bottom of this cistern. Cistern is like a well that they dig out of rock in Syria, Palestine, that area, Israel area, you know, that the Holy Land, let's call it. To catch rainwater that runs off during the rainy season. And so they dig them down. Some are really big, some are really deep. I think under the Temple Mount, there's this huge cistern. It holds like a couple of millions of gallons. That's why Jerusalem was able to withstand the sieges of Jerusalem. They had these water sources inside Jerusalem. Huge carved out cave cisterns where it's full of water. So they threw Joseph down this cistern. And there wasn't any water in it. So he didn't drown. He's alive. But he was trapped down there. He couldn't get out, couldn't climb out. The walls are all plastered, smoothly plastered, and there's no way to climb out of that. Stuck. He's just gonna starve to death there. And Judas said, "Hey, look, he's our own flesh, our own flesh and blood. He's one of us. We can't do this to him. You know, we cannot do this to him. Just absolutely, this is not acceptable at all." And so he had the idea, let's sell him to this caravan and, you know, let him go about his life. And so that's what they did. They hauled, they put a little rope down, they hauled Joseph out of the cistern and sold him to a caravan, just headed down towards Egypt. And the caravan in turn sold him to, as a slave or in Egypt, to someone who was had a rather high position there in Egypt. And then Joseph distinguished himself in helping this person. The story goes on and on. But the idea is that Joseph eventually repented, you see. So Judah understood God's plan of repentance and said, look, your spirit can't die. This is all a pretense. But you're not going to solve this pretense by continuing to dwell in the bottom of a cistern. That's just not going to work. So get out of the cistern, go through Egypt, you know, and gradually you're going to move towards repentance. Okay? So Judah understood God's plan of salvation. You see, the others didn't. The others didn't. So that's why Judah was made, you know, his lineage of Judah is the lineage of kings of Israel. All kings of Israel have to come from the lineage of Judah. That's why Jesus came from that lineage, same as King David. And Jesus indeed said, I am the king of the Jews. People said, you're the king of the Jews. Absolutely. King of that lineage, I mean the king of that, of God's plan of salvation. Jesus is the one who understands it perfectly, has full authority to present and press this plan of salvation upon us and get us through. So Joseph, instead of just trying to make death real, he was put through, you know, was put through all sorts of situations that gradually brought him to a measure of repentance, you know, and Judah played a role in that too, offering his own life as insurance for the other. If the other didn't come back, then his own life would be forfeited. You know, if Benjamin didn't return, his own life would be forfeited. He agreed to Joseph to do that, and Joseph was so moved by that. He said, wow, you know, this Judah is really something. And eventually, you know, it broke him down, and he admitted who he really was. So he went down to Egypt pretending he was somebody he wasn't. And then finally he admitted to the brothers, yeah, I'm actually Joseph and the one that you sent away. And so there's a sort of a spiritual story to all this, that eventually we realize, yeah, you know, we're spirit. We tried to, you know, pretend that we weren't. We tried to fake our own suicide, but that doesn't work. So Judah realized that spirit's just trying to fake its own death, and that can never work. There is no sufferer. So we have no choice but to get out of that cistern and go through the trail of being brought to repentance. So see, Judah was the one who understood this. And that's why, you know, Jacob blessed him with the lineage of being the kings of Israel. And so Jesus was the fulfillment, was the final, you know, Messiah, the promised king, greatest of all kings of Israel. But he reminded us his kingdom is not of this world. This is a spiritual kingdom. It's a spiritual lineage. So, yeah. Jesus' kingdom is where we recognize that nothing, no suffering can happen to anything. I mean, suffering cannot happen to spirit. at all. Nor can it really happen to anything at all. It's just a dream of symptoms. We can dream of symptoms. They have no effect. They have no effect. So why even keep dreaming of symptoms? You see, this is just folly. So the death-free realm is the realm, Jesus' kingdom, where we don't even dream of symptoms. There are no symptoms of suffering, misery, death upon every nature. We see a nature where there's no suffering at all. There's no illness, sickness, death, aging, none of that. So we give up the dream of symptoms. I hope this is still recording. Yeah. Okay. We exchange this dream of symptoms for a dream of no symptoms. Okay? We give up this dream of symptoms that are trying to assert that spirit has died for a dream of symptoms where it asserts that spirit hasn't died. In other words, there's no aging, there's no death, there's no sickness, there's no vulnerability, there's no infirmity, there's no accidents, there's none of that. That's the Jesus' kingdom, the kingdom of heaven that he's talking about. And so once we get used to this kingdom, then the repentance is finished, fully repented. And we don't need to dream at all. We don't need to do anything at all. That's the end of all dreaming. We're so used to pretending, dreaming, that we're afraid to put it all down at once. So we'll step a dream of this kingdom, the death-free realm, where, oh, look at that tree, it's perfect. It's not sick, it's never aged, it can never die, it's always been here. Oh, that reminds me that spirit can't die. Yeah, everything then in that kingdom of heaven reminds us that spirit can't die, that all death is only dream. All death is only a dream of symptoms with nothing to apply it to. Nothing to apply it to. So those who don't want that will continue on with this world or worlds like this where it's a dream of symptoms of suffering and death with no sufferer. Again, the Jesus' kingdom, there's no dream of death here at all. There's a dream of life. And who can we apply that to? Oh, we can apply that to spirit, right? And say, hey, this reminds me of spirit. Yeah, spirit can't suffer. Spirit can't die. This really reminds me of who I am, what I am. How about that? Fantastic. So, it's go, 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 go time. I mean, the apocalypse, who knows what's the next veil to be lifted is. I mean, the veils are being lifted all constantly. Almost everything that happened, I mean, everything is happening in the news. It's revealing, very revealing, by the responses or lack thereof. People are being outed. I mean, the POTUS is being outed, severely outed. I mean, it's just, so out of the bag there. It's just, you know, why even pretend it isn't? I mean, just the responses or lack thereof is astonishing. Just astonishing. And you realize, wow, okay, this is the role he's really playing. Okay. And we knew all along, but now it's becoming, you know, very obvious. Can't really hide it anymore, except you can just try to sweep on the rug and say, well, they're all clowns, they're all fools, they're all crazies. And then you're stuck with it, but they're crazies, you know. Can't listen to anything they say. I can't listen to anything they say. They're complete crazies. So you're having this complete division now of those who want to continue to be caught up in this pretense of symptoms of death, hoping that they can find a sufferer, and those who are saying, wait a minute, I don't really think that's the right way to go. There's the sheep and the goats are being divided now. This is the whole purpose of the apocalypse, is the division of the sheep and the goats. So the one who wants to continue with the dream of death have to view those who don't want to as crazies. I mean, absolutely crazies. They're complete crazies. I don't want to listen to them at all. I can't listen to them. That would make me feel uncomfortable. They make me feel uncomfortable. They should be, you know, let's gas them all. You know, they're making me feel uncomfortable now. That kind of situation. So this division is now happening. Very, very rapidly, very, very quickly and severely. That's a great thing. It's a great thing. It's about time, you know? So I don't know what I'll do from day to day. I don't know what's next. I don't know what's next. It has to be something very significant because my own situation is deteriorating, you know? So it has to be very fast. The demand, you know, to succumb to the symptoms, keep pretending that you're, you know, succumbing to the symptoms is becoming very, very strong. And you really can't listen to those who are insisting on that because they're so crazy that you might get pulled into it. Those are the real crazies, you know. They're expert projectionists. This is what they do. Their whole stock and trade is projection. This is how they keep functioning. Whatever they're feeling inside that's scaring them, they project it out and blame someone else for it. So when they're feeling this craziness inside, like, oh my gosh, what we're doing is doubling down. This is so crazy. I'm going into severe craziness. They say, wait a minute. I think I know the answer. I'll just project that out on the ones who aren't doing this and call them crazy and see them as crazy. That solves the problem. And this is called doubling down on craziness, which is what they're doing. Unfortunately, I've warned them not to do this. Very few have listened. Yeah. What can you do? You can sound the warning, raise the flag, you know, and people don't salute, they don't salute. But doubling down on projection is, you know, very, very ineffective. And it's in the short term it seems effective, like it's magically effective, but long term, very bad strategy. At the very least, just don't project. Just go into the wow mode. You see, this is what I'm saying. This will help everyone. Just go into the wow, like, wow. I've been deceiving myself. Okay, wow, wow. Just say wow. You don't need to say anything else. Repentance starts with wow. Starts and ends with wow, and it's wow in between. That's all you have to do. It's not like you have to beat yourself up. You just feel the wow. That's all I've done. It's just wow. I tried to deceive myself. I tried to pretend like I could die. You know, I tried to double down on that. I tried to use projection to make it seem more realistic. Wow. Okay, I see this. Just wow. That's all you have to do is just feel the wow. Nothing else. I don't feel guilt, you know. I just feel this wow. This is shocking. That's the path. The path is shocking. It's just accepting the wowness of it. And you don't beat yourself up. You don't feel guilty. You don't feel terrible. I'm this wretched, terrible. No. Or I'm this horribly foolish. No, you just say, wow. I really went so far trying to pretend that I had committed suicide. Wow. That's amazing. And you respect yourself for it. You don't hate yourself. You say, wow, that was really audacious, wasn't it? Very creatively audacious, and also, but really quite absurd too, right? Yeah. Absurdly audacious. So you're just like, wow, okay. And I promise you, that's the reaction. You won't hate yourself. You'll have sort of an admiration. You know, just like, wow. You admire it, but also, that was really stupid. Really reckless and stupid. I'm not going to do that again. But you admire the sheer audacity of trying to pull this off, even how ridiculous it was, but still. There's admiration for our creativity and for our adventurousness and for our spirit, you know, just like never say die. I'm going to just try and pretend like I can commit suicide and trick guilt, and this will enable me to be greater than God. And it's like, wow. Again, so yeah, don't worry about, oh, okay, some adverse reaction on this terror. No, you'll just have a wow reaction. As long as you cling to the wow, you'll be okay. As long as you cling to the wow, you'll be okay. You don't need to cling to your quote-unquote guns and Bible, as the cave dwellers say, but cling to the wow, cling to the wow. That'll get you through. So it's the same. Both the the wacko New Ageists and the entrenched conservatives, both of them, the remedy is the same for the crazies and the those who may not be quite that crazy, or you might say have a different, slightly different style of crazy. It, whatever, however you say it, the remedy is the same as the wow. Just go into the wow. Both sides can do that. Both sides of polarity can do that. Both sides of the coin can do that. Just go into the wow. I'm not asking for anyone to beat themselves up, you know, say, oh, I was so wrong, I was so terrible. Well, I mean, the whole thing was crazy, right? I mean, trying to fake its own suicide, fake its own, you know, commit fake suicide. That's pretty hilarious. Trying to convince what doesn't exist that it doesn't exist anymore. Hey, nothing. Guess what? You don't exist anymore. How can you tell what has never existed that it doesn't convince it that it doesn't exist anymore? This is the trouble, right? This is the craziness. That's why Jesus says, don't try to make illusions real and then convince them that they're illusions. This is what we're trying to do. We're saying, hey, guilt, you don't exist anymore. But there's no guilt there. So we're really saying, hey, nothing, that which has never existed, you don't exist anymore. Well, of course, that means that you're saying that it did exist. So you're denying that it has never existed. So you're denying reality, right? Because in reality, it has never existed. So to try and convince nothing that it doesn't exist anymore is really an arrogant denial of reality. So that way does not work. So how are we doing here? Pretty good. I'm gaining more weight because I'm eating ice cream every night because I'm nervous, you know? It's like, wow, how can I handle, you know, this, to speak the truth in this world, which sounds to be preposterous. I'm already doing it, but the reaction, you know, if people that you socialize with, you know, they're going to maybe pretend that you're a complete clown, you know, which I've gotten my whole life, actually. Sometimes I got so angry, sometimes I acted like a clown. So, you're insisting that I'm a clown? Okay, I'll act like a clown then. But then I got over that and said, nah, that's not the answer, you know. Very frustrating, though, when people, the only reaction they have to you is that you're just a total clown, complete idiot, nonsense, preposterous clown. That's it. And you know that you're not. You know, you feel like, wow, maybe I'll teach him a lesson. But it doesn't work. Just a waste of time. Then they'll just say, oh, you see? I told you were a clown. That's what they say. See, I was right. Now, get out of my face, you know. Actually, they're happy. Oh, yeah, see, I was right. You're a clown. That's great. I was right. So it's really the pressure they put on you to prove to them that they're right. Say, you're a clown. I want you to prove to me you're a clown. You know, I succumbed to that pressure to some extent. But then I said, wait a minute. You know, that's not it. Let's get back to work here. As I knew it would be very hard work, and it has been very intensely difficult work. Intense pressure and difficulty every single day. But, you know, what else is there to do here? It's either that or keep trying to pretend that spirit has committed suicide and then convince guilt, non-existent guilt, that is true. I mean, that's not much fun. I mean, that's a lot of pressure too, and there's no payoff. You know, you just spin your wheels. That's not, you know, spinning your wheels is not really getting anywhere. You might think, well, I'm accelerating, so I'm that's great, but you're forgetting that the wheels are just spinning. You're not getting anywhere. Just burning the wheels out. So at some point you got to realize, whoa, just because I step on the accelerator doesn't necessarily mean that I'm going anywhere. You have to have some sort of traction. And the traction is the wow. Put the wow underneath the tires, it gives it traction, and you start going somewhere. Or you start realizing that there's nowhere you need to go. Nothing you need to do. Don't need to convince what has never existed that it doesn't exist. We're spending all our time trying to convince what has never existed and never will exist that it doesn't exist anymore. It's now non-existent. Then first, but of course, then we have to figure out, well, how did it exist in the first place? You know, I got to have something to convince. How can I be convincing if there's nothing to convince? So we don't have to convince anything, except to be convinced that we don't have to convince anything. That's it. We're getting pretty far along on this video here. Now, after this video, pressure's still on. I mean, you know, this is a good step, but it certainly is not far enough. I mean, hasn't gone far enough. This is the trouble. But what can you do except evaporate the wow? Keep evaporating the wow. Keep bringing the wow in and evaporating it. It's a little difficult to apply it. This to, you know, everyday socialization, isn't it? This is the trouble I've always had. But there has to be a way. There has to be a way. So I still feel, you know, that there's some hang up, you know, that hasn't been, but what can I do except keep on expressing the truth here and just keep speaking in this seemingly preposterous manner and do a better and better job of it, and somehow it will click at some point. I've already had a number of breakthroughs where I felt like I'm capable of doing this, you know, I can do this, and then the continuity fear kind of creeps back in.